Shalom, everybody. Rabbi Edelstein here with another installment of Rabbi Ian 3, brought to you by Meor DC. MeorDC.com, our website, or find us on Facebook. And if you're in university, like at GW or elsewhere in DC, you can apply for the Maimonides Jewish Leaders Fellowship, an amazing 10-week seminar on Jewish ideas with guest speakers and a stipend. Check it out. Apply. Come on board. Okay, now. This week's Torah portion is so exciting, I got to control myself. It's B'Shalach. I really mean, every Torah portion is amazing, but this one has so many incredible subjects. You have the splitting of the sea, right? The Jewish people left Egypt in last week's Torah portion. It's called B'Shalach, this week's Torah portion. They left Egypt, but God hardens Pharaoh's hearts, and he and his army and chariots and horsemen pursue the Jewish people to the Sea of Reeds. They don't know what to do. They're crying out to God. They're yelling at Moses. The sea splits. They go in on dry land. And then the waters, when the Egyptians, in a headlong frenzy, a craziness, go to follow in the Jewish people. Of course, the waters come back and destroy the Egyptian army. That's the splitting of the sea. That's one of the topics in this week's Torah portion. Then the incredible, ecstatic song of joy, the Shirat Hayam, that the Jewish people sing after witnessing the revelation of God's power and glory and majesty at the sea. They sing Shirat Hayam, a beautiful, beautiful, that we say every day in our morning prayers. And then there's the beginning of the journey in the desert after the sea splitting, a little bit of complaining, and then the man comes, the manna. You got to read this Torah portion. You got to read it, B'Shalach. Okay. But that was, and forgive me if I'm a little manic, I want to be within the 3 minutes, Rabbi 3, I'm trying to be better about that, okay? But here, the first verse is what I want to focus in on for a minute or a minute and a half. It says when God led the Jewish people out of Mitzrayim, Egypt, he didn't take them in the most direct way to the promised land. He took them in a circuitous way, and the Torah says, because God knows his customers, knows his people, that if they might see war or other dangers, maybe some people would come out to attack them, they might be frightened, and if they were very close to Egypt, they would run back. Imagine that, run back to the slavery of Egypt rather than face the dangers in the desert. God knows human nature. Even if you've seen 10 plagues of Hashem in Egypt, and you still might be scared in a moment of panic and want to go back to what's familiar. Okay, so why am I mentioning that? Well, God was showing in his wisdom what I would call strategic thinking. He knows the Jewish people. He knows they might be tempted to run back if they're close to Mitzrayim, Egypt. So he takes them in a circuitous way. That's strategic thinking. That's a place you don't want to go to. There might be danger there. I take you in a different way. Why am I mentioning that? God doesn't need, I mean, God is smart. But we're not so smart. Do we think strategically? When we have something we want to achieve or something we want to avoid, and we know it with a clarity, and we might even be inspired or passionate to change that bad habit or develop that good habit. But how often do we use strategic thinking, intellectual, sitting down and figuring out the steps to avoid that or to get to there? I'll speak for myself. I read a lot of books of ethical teachings as a rabbi, and it interests me, but I don't do that as much as I should. I get inspiration, and I get ideas, and I'm fired up. But then you have to have strategic thinking to implement your great ideas, to develop the pathway to achieve something or to avoid something. If you think about it in a big way, the whole Torah is a strategy. Strategy to channel our spirituality, our inspiration. It can be inspired sometimes, but the Torah channels it into pathways of connectedness. Strategies. Get a strategy. Have a great Shabbos.